to quiet your hearts and come before Him. As we start, just make yourself aware of the Lord's presence here. That He's here. That He desires to connect with us, for us to encounter Him. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. I will glory in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt His name together. I sought the Lord, and He answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to Him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear Him, and He delivers them. Father, we thank You this morning for the opportunity to come and to behold You, to look upon Your Son, Jesus. Jesus, we've come to magnify You, to glorify You, to put You at the center. And we thank You, we're here because You've delivered us from our sin. You've delivered us from the enemy. And God, You continue to deliver us, Lord, in every moment of our life. We thank You that You are faithful, that You are good. And God, we just don't want to say that from our lips, but we want to know that in our heart. And so even right now, God, if there are any barriers, any hindrances, if there's even physical tiredness, distraction, Father, I pray those things would all be gone in Jesus' name. And that You would give us grace to worship You and to encounter You and to walk away transformed even in the moment. We thank You, Father. It's in Your name we pray. Amen. Rise with me.
I cast my mind to Calvary. Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. Body bound and drenched in tears, they laid Him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is Your sting? The angels roar, for Christ our King. Oh, praise the name. We're singing praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord our God.
He shall return.
Shall return in robes of white, The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Sing that again. He shall return.
He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Let's lift our voices together to Him.
Oh, praise the name of the
decision. Let Him know, God, I've come to worship You. I will not stand and spectate. I will not stand at a distance, but I want to draw in. I want to engage You, God. I want to know Your heart. I want to see Your face. I want to hear Your voice. Just in Your own words, just begin to lift that up. Say, God, I decide. Or maybe you're not there yet, but say, God, would You help me to get there? Help me to get there to worship. To not stand at distance, but to come close. Ask Him, let your breath
come from heaven, fill our hearts with Your life. We are here for You. We are here for You.
To You our hearts.
To You our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are one desire. You alone are holy. Only You are worthy. God, let Your fire fall down. Let our shouts be Your anthem. Your word move in power. Let what's dead come to life. We are here for You. Yes, God, we are here for You. To You our hearts, yeah. To You our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are one. alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. To you our hearts are open. Yes, to you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down. Let your fire fall down. Let your fire fall down, even now, God. Oh, we welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this. Let every heart adore. Let every heart awake. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. 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 Yeah, to you our hearts. Oh, to you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall.
Come on, let's ask.
You, our hearts are open, nothing here is hidden. You are my one desire. You alone are holy, only you are worthy, God. Let your fire fall down.
Come on, even right now, if there's anyone in the room who is thirsty, who is hungry for the Lord, who feels dry, who's been struggling, feeling aimless or unsettled, facing anxiety, I just want to invite you, just in your own heart, to ask the Lord to come and meet you. Say, Lord, I need you. I need you more than I know. I need you. I don't want to hide because you see everything already. And you invite me to come. Your heart is one of love and mercy, kindness. So if that's you, I just invite you to come. Even if it's not, just a moment right now to draw into Him, to open up our entire being. Say, Lord, come. Come away. You to open your hands.
Let your glory now invade. One more of you, Spirit, come and fill this place. Let your glory now invade. Let's cry out together. Spirit, come. Oh, Spirit, come and fill this place. Oh, we're desperate for you, God. Let your glory.
Together.
Spirit of the living God, come fall afresh on me. Come wake me from my sleep.
We've come to behold you, to be with you, because that's why we were created, to worship you. Father, I pray that this morning every person in this room would encounter you. Not one person would be left out, but that every person here would feel the manifest presence of God. Speak to us through the preaching of your word, through the time of prayer, through every aspect of this worship. For all of us, Lord, whether we know it or not, we need you. We need you. Father, we know that living where we live, it may seem like we don't need much, but we're actually very needy. And this world cannot satisfy, it cannot fill our need. It's only you, and so we come to you, God. Would you move in power and have your way this morning? It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Wow. Morning, everybody. And thank you, Pastor Sam, for that jolt of praise. Who's not moved this morning? Welcome to the RCC morning service. For those who gathering for the first time, please linger along and join us in fellowship. Can we just take a brief minute to welcome those around you? Great, okay. So our first announcement is the last day of today's, of our stellar VBS. Shine Jesus' light is a theme. I just want to share something from Pastor Eunice. She asked us to please continue to pray for our children to be blessed, safe, and have fun learning about when people are in need, shine Jesus' light. So I thought that was great, shine Jesus' light. Next announcement is for our retreat. It's coming in 2 weeks. For those who haven't signed up yet, please, I think there are still room, so please contact Helen. It's been a while, but we've been able to have the gym made available after fellowship. So about 1:30 to 4, you can come play basketball, volleyball, or just exercise. So yeah, if you can make that, please join us. If you see your name in the worship circle, please come, prepare your hearts, come at about 10:30. In the library adjacent to the sanctuary for a prayer time together. At this time, I'd like to introduce Pastor Sean for the clay announcements.
All right, good morning, church. Some clay announcement and crew announcement. Our Bible study is taking place today, so please join us after worship service. Our FNF is every Friday, 8 p.m. here at church. But this coming up Friday, due to our mission trip, we'll be postponing the meeting. For our Mexico mission team, our last training is taking place tonight, so please come, 7:30 in the clay room. For clay, our retreat will be separate, will be held separate service, so please join us. The topic for us is the holiness of God and the pastor coming to share the word of God. His name is Pastor Chun-suk. So please continue to lift up a prayer for him. And crew gathering also is taking place every Tuesday, 6:30 p.m. here at church. But this coming up Tuesday, due to mission, we'll be postponing the gathering as well. I believe that is all the announcements at this time. I'd like to invite Deaconess Haesin for offering and congregational prayer.
All right, good morning, church. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we gather here as your beloved congregation, united in spirit and gratitude as we pray for the offering you have bestowed upon us. May our offering be used to support the work of your kingdom, both within our church and in the broader world. Lord, we pray that you bless and multiply these offerings and guide us in using our resources wisely and generously to bring ultimate glory to you, Father God. Today, we send off our Mexico mission team on a journey of purpose and service. Where you are, there is majesty and perfection. We pray for each member, James and Lucas Chen, Jack Kim, Jason Koo, Avery Park, Stephen Park, Gabe and Michael Vukosavovic, and our team leader, Pastor Sean. Grant them courage and boldness to step out in faith, knowing that you are with them every step of the way. May they be filled with your Holy Spirit, empowering them to bring hope, healing, and the message of your love to those they encounter. Lord, we pray for safety, guidance, and protection as they embark on this mission. Father God, we also lift up in prayer for the children, volunteers, and teachers for BVS as they wrap up our annual event today. Thank you for the opportunity to spread your word in this special time of fellowship and learning. We pray that the mustard seed of faith planted in their hearts and mind take root and flourish in their lives. We are blessed with teachers and volunteers who have dedicated their time and efforts to make this Vacation Bible School possible. We seek your divine guidance and blessings for the well-being of their souls. We offer these prayers, trusting in your unfailing love and mercy. May your will be done, and may your grace be sufficient for all our needs. With our hearts filled with faith and gratitude, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
This time before we receive the word of God, I would like to take this time to commission our Mexico mission team. I think we have a slide, a couple of slides. So before we have the team come up and receive prayer, I'd like to just briefly share what we'll be doing at Mexico, Tijuana. Our main focus ministry is, of course, VBS. We'll be partnering with the local church there, and with the teachers and the pastors there will be hosting VBS for a few days. And then I believe the church, the main church that we're going to be at, they have planted a church, and so they need a lot of help with construction, painting, and moving things. And so we'll be participating in renovating and painting the church, and we'll be making a nursing home visitation. Last year we couldn't because COVID. They still had COVID restrictions, but this year missionary Isaac has shared how we could visit these nursing homes, and then at these nursing home. We probably, serve food and maybe, cut their nails and haircuts and things like that, and probably clean up their rooms and things like that. So we'll be having a nursing home visitation and then street evangelism as well, where we will go out and tell them about the VBS that we are hosting, and probably invite them to come to church on that Sunday. So a big exciting time of ministry, a blessed time. And so please pray for our ministry as we go off to Mexico, Tijuana, tomorrow morning. At this time, if I call your name, please come on up. And we'll have a time where we could pray for these team members. So James Chan, Lucas Chan, Jack Kim, Jason Koo, Avery Park. If I call your name, please come on home. Stephen Park, Gabe, and Michael, and myself. So it's, come on up and you can just face the congregation. It says in the book of Acts, chapter 13, where Paul and Barnabas is sent off by the church of Antioch. The elders have come together as they were set apart by the Holy Spirit, that they have laid their hands upon these, Paul and Barnabas, and they were sent off as they fasted and prayed for them, and they sent off to do the work of God. And this time, I would like to kindly ask all the family members of these team members, and as well as any pastors or elders in the house of God right now, if we can all just kind of come up and lay our hands upon these brothers, and let's pray for them. I believe we have a slide where a prayer request. So again, all the family members, the elders and the pastors, if you're in the house of God, please, I would like to invite us to come up and lay our hands. And our church, our congregation, if you can just extend your hands from where you are. Just extend your hands from where you are and let's pray for this team and the ministry that God has given us. As you can see from the slide here, our prayer request, safe travels, obviously. Health, that we would go in good condition and come back healthy. We do have some students who have allergies and things like that, and we pray for just blessing of health, team unity. Pray that the love of God will continuously bind us together to do the work of God together, and again the ministry time that we have, that it would be blessing unto others, that we make a great holy impact on in Tijuana. Just personal learning and growth for all of our brothers here, all of our team members, that they would at least learn something, take away something from going on this trip. And lastly, tying with that, just maturity in our faith, that our faith in Christ would grow, that our faith in Christ would be deepened, and our relationship with it, with Him will be deepened. And so at this time, with these topics, let's cry out to God, lift up this team together. Let us pray. Lord Father God, we thank you so much for this opportunity where we can send off this great team. Lord God, it says in your scripture, Lord, that your elders, the church will come together as the team will be set apart by the Holy Spirit, and they will go off and do the work and task that you have given them. Lord God, I'd like to invite our missions committee at Elder Stan.
Thank you, Church. I'd just like to say a couple of words before I do a final prayer for you guys. See me. Okay, I'll go over here. I just want to say for our missionaries that are out there, I am very excited for you. I'm so excited that I wore my t-shirt actually today from last year or so. And I just want to say some words of wisdom from a missionary that I have gone a bunch of times to. And just want to say, just be less self-conscious about yourself and be more deliberate for the Lord. And we say all these words, and what does that actually mean? I mean, when you're out there, when you're doing body worship, do it for the Lord. Do it with purpose and really do it with no reserve. When you're walking in the streets, gathering the kids for the VBS, do it for the Lord. Do it with purpose and with no reserve. Shout, El Niños, Jesus te ama. No falten. Have that passion. When you're painting the walls, do it for the Lord. Do it with purpose and do it with no reserve. When you're really on your third hour of manning that activity station, have perseverance and know why you're there, really, for the Lord. And most of all, just have fun. That will get you through. That will just have fun and just be in the Lord as you're there. We pray, actually, for all those lasting memories. And now go on to the mission field and just enjoy it. Let's end with a prayer. Church, as we go into our prayer. Loving and gracious God, today as we gather here with hearts full of hope and spirits soaring high, we present before you our young missionaries. We gather here today in your presence to commission our faithful young people who are embarking on an 8-day mission to Tijuana, Mexico. We pray, Lord, that you please, please bless James Chen, bless Lucas Chen, bless Stephen Park, bless Gabe Vukasavovich, bless Michael Vukasavovich, bless Jason Koo, bless Avery Park, bless Jack Kim, and of course, bless Pastor Sean, knowing that you've called them to this journey of service and love. Lord, we commission them in your name, knowing that their journey is filled with purpose to make a difference, to touch lives, and to spread the good news of your kingdom, Heavenly Father. We pray that you empower them, inspire them, and direct their hearts and minds in every task they undertake, Heavenly Father. As the psalmist writes, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. We ask that your word guide them, illuminate a path of service they have chosen, Heavenly Father. Be their wisdom when they encounter confusion. Be their strength when they face difficulties. And be their comfort when they feel weary, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, again, equip them with courage and the tenacity to fortify their faith and embed within them a deep sense of commitment to the task they have undertaken. Heavenly Father, also, may they also remember that they are not just representing our church, Heavenly Father, but also you, O Lord, in every word that they speak, every deed that they perform, and encourage them, really, to be true disciples, sharing the love of Christ with everyone they meet. Father, we also pray for the communities that they will serve. Soften their hearts for those who will hear your word, as they may make it plant the seeds of faith, hope, and love. May their efforts yield a harvest of unity, understanding, and peace, really promoting a deeper connection with you, Heavenly Father. We place our trust in you, knowing that with you, all things are possible. Let your spirit guide our young missionaries, and let their lives be a living testimony to your unending love and grace. In your most holy name we pray, amen.
All right, let's encourage them with a round of applause. Thank you. You may be seated.
Also, I want to give one, when I was going to middle school with my kids, we had a Boston trip, and we went through a trip there, and the guide always said, the colonialists gave an encouraging shout when they were rebelling against the British. So I want to say this one thing, huzzah! Okay, as you go into the thing.
So glad to be here to open up God's Word with you. I've been so encouraged by brothers and sisters at RCC for some of you for 10 years, some of you 20 years, some of you for almost 30 years. I've known brothers and sisters here. We've grown together. We've labored in ministry in the northern New Jersey area. And God has challenged us. God has broken us, and God has remade us to depend less on ourselves and more on Him. As I was praying about today's message, he led me to Revelation chapter 3. And next week will be Revelation chapter 7. And I know that Revelation can be a confusing book. I know that you will have many questions, as well as challenges and encouragements. So if you want to process this message after this sermon, today after the worship, I'm going to have a short Q&A time. I want you to process with me, not just intellectually, but in your heart and soul. I want you to practice the application of what God is saying, not only to the church of Laodicea, but the church of Bergen County. God is working, and he wants to work in your life, and he wants to work in my life, that we would become more like Jesus. Would you turn with me in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 3? I'm going to read verses 14 and following. Please listen to God's word, not just with your ears, but with your heart and soul. To the angel of the church in Laodicea, write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm about to spit you out from my mouth. You say, I am rich. I've acquired wealth and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so you can become rich, nakedness, and white clothes to wear so that you could cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so that you could see. Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door of their heart, I will come in and eat with that person, and they with me. This is God's word. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, thank you for the words that you spoke 2,000 years ago to not only the church of Laodicea, but the church of Bergen County. We pray that you would help us to listen to your voice, help us to be convicted in our hearts, help us to apply in our lives the truth of your word and what you are teaching us, that we would not deceive ourselves. We need you, Lord. We need you to stir our hearts to be passionate, fervent for you, because you are the Savior of the world, to draw all nations to yourself. In Jesus' powerful name we pray. Amen. Some of you are familiar with ancient Near East history, and you know that Laodicea was not only a large city in what is now modern Turkey, but it was a center of commerce. It was a place where many businesses thrived. But it was not only a place where many businesses thrived, but the medical profession. There were many medical universities in Laodicea. There was not only large business and great medical schools in Laodicea, but they also have a great fashion industry. Much like our New York City, is it not? That we have great commerce, we have great education, particularly in the health profession, and we also have great fashion in New York City, because it is not only a large city, but a city that impacts many other cities. And we who live in northern New Jersey are often impacted by the influences of that culture of seeking wealth and financial security, by seeking education as a means to get ahead in society and to look good, not just in clothes, but in overall appearance, including health. So this is what God is saying, not only to the church of Laodicea, but he's saying to the church of Bergen County as well. Verse 15, I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. Now, those of you who are an employment of a company with many employees, those of you who are students and go to school, you know there are two types of classmates, actually three types of classmates at school, and three types of coworkers at work. One is that there are some people that like you and they want to help you and they're your friend, and they want to encourage you in your profession, in your career, but also in your schoolwork. And then there's another group of students that really don't care about you, maybe even try to make fun of you, maybe pick on you, and you have that at work as well, that there are some people who are jealous of you at work. They'll do anything to undermine you. They might even gossip about you. But then there's a third type of person at school and at work. And I think every one of us has experienced that type of person. And they are people who pretend to be your friend, who will have a smile when they see you face to face, but when your back is turned, they're attacking your character. They're gossiping about you. And that is worse than being your enemy, is it not? God is saying to us that there are many people in the churches in Bergen County today that come to church and say, Jesus, you are amazing. I love you. You are God. But when they go to work on Monday, they totally forget Jesus. They're blaspheming his name. They're talking about things that are against God's word. Brothers and sisters, let me ask you, are you a lukewarm Christian? Are you passive in your faith? Are you duplicitous in your walk with God? Then God is saying to you very clearly, I will spit you out of my mouth. If you are a Sunday Christian, if you come to church with that smile and say, praise the Lord, Jesus is God, on Sunday and Monday to Saturday, you live as if God does not exist, then you, my friends, are lukewarm Christian. In fact, Jesus says, I never knew you. You might say, Lord, Lord, did we not go on a missions trip in your name? Lord, Lord, did we not teach Sunday school in your name? Lord, Lord, did we not do VBS in your name? Lord, Lord, didn't we clean up the high school in Elmwood Park in your name? And Jesus will say to some of you, get away from me, you evildoers. I never knew you. That's shocking. That passage in Matthew 7 is one of the scariest passages in the Bible. Jesus is warning us to wake up, to open our eyes, to soften our hearts, to know when we are lukewarm in our faith, that we have lost our first love, and that he wants us to come to him, to know him, to love him. He says in verse 17, you say, I am rich, I've acquired wealth, and do not need a thing, but you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. Remember, Laodicea was a wealthy city. There was thriving commerce, and everyone aspired to gain more and more wealth. You know, most of you know that New York City wasn't the first name for New York City. New York City was called what before New York City? It was called New Amsterdam. Do you know why it was called New Amsterdam? Because the English didn't settle Manhattan first. It was the Dutch. But you know, when Dutch people and most people immigrate to the city, when they make a little money, where do they come? To the suburbs. And you know that many of the Dutch settlers moved west and moved north. And just like many immigrant families, when you make money, when you make it in the city, when you do the blood, sweat, and tears of an immigrant family, survive decades in the city, you move out to the burbs where you have a driveway, yes. You have a lawn. You have a 5-bedroom house. But that fine security is not your righteousness. That big home is not the proof that you've made it. God looks at your heart. Mankind looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. When God looks at you, what does he see? Does he see a heart that's devoted and hungering and thirsting for God's righteousness? Or are you hungering and thirsting to win the Powerball lottery? Yes, I know some of you bought a ticket. God knows too. But brothers and sisters, he's saying, do you understand that every single one of us are poor in spirit? That you and I, my friends, are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked without Jesus. We are nothing. Even if you graduate from an Ivy League institution, you are nothing without Jesus. Even if you have a PhD, you are nothing without Jesus. Even if you drive a Lamborghini, yes, you are nothing without Jesus. Because you're using your wealth, you're using your education, you're using your degrees, you're using your physical appearance to cover temporarily your shameful nakedness. And God sees it, and he wants you to see it too. It's only when we recognize that we are pitiful, poor, blind, and naked that we can come to Jesus and say, Lord, nothing in my hands I bring, simply to the cross I cling. And that's why it tells us in verse 18, I counsel you to buy for me gold refined in the fire so that you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so that you could cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so that you can see. Jesus is telling us to come to him, to buy from him his eternal wealth. Now, how do we buy eternal wealth? Some of you hopefully remember Isaiah 55 that says, without money and without cost, the Lord Messiah calls you to come and buy and eat the finest of meats, the best kalbi, yes, to enjoy the filet mignon that God gives to you that you cannot afford on your own, but he gives to you if you just empty your pocket and say, Lord, I have nothing. You are my everything. Brothers and sisters, some of you remember that kind of devotion you once had to the Lord, but it is a distant memory. And your heart has gone cold because you have pursued the deceitfulness of wealth. You know, in the Bible, most people think that sexual immorality is the sinful temptation that the Bible warns against the most. It's not. The sinful temptation that the Bible warns against us the most, it's actually twice as often that God warns us against this sinful temptation more than sexual immorality. Do you know what it is? It's financial immorality. That's right. The deceitfulness of wealth, the temptation of wealth, the temptation of trying to make something of yourself, to feel significant, to gain status by your wealth, is a false god. You cannot love both God and money. So many of us have drifted from our passion from God because we've been distracted by the love of money. Money itself is not wrong. Sex itself is not wrong. Sex is a beautiful gift to enjoy in the context of marriage. But if you use it outside of God's direction, it will burn you. Same thing with money. Money is a tool, but the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Do you love money more than you love the Lord? Do you love your career more than you love the Lord? He wants you to empty your pocket and say, Lord, nothing in my hands, nothing in my pockets I bring. Simply to the cross I cling. You are my righteousness. And you remember what 2 Corinthians 5 teaches us. He who was eternally rich became poor for our sakes, so that we who were poor could be made rich in Christ. That is our righteousness. He is our God. He is our Savior. He is our joy. He is our wealth. He is your treasure and your great reward. He also tells us in verse 18 that he counsels us to put on his clothes to wear so that we could cover our shamefulness. Listen, many of us cover our shamefulness not only through wealth, but for my performance. I want to share with the missions team. When I was a high school senior, I was the president of my youth group at a church in Philadelphia called Korean United Church of Philadelphia. It was the largest Korean church in Philadelphia at that time. There were 100 kids in the youth group. And as the president of the youth group, I was, you know, expected to lead the way, to lead in prayer, to teach Sunday school sometimes. But I realized in the middle of my senior year, I wasn't a Christian. It is possible to be in the youth group. It is possible to even be the president of your youth group. It is possible to be a deacon. It's even possible to be a pastor without coming to genuine faith. You might talk the talk. You might look the part, but your heart is not in it. Because something happened my senior year that changed my life forever. I went on a retreat, and I was actually just worshiping. I wasn't even listening to a message, but it was through the song that Jesus opened my eyes and God showed me, Jim, you are a hypocrite. You are lukewarm. Because on Sunday, you pretend to be this nice guy that knows all the Sunday school answers, but you don't know me and you don't love me. I died for you. Come to me. And all of a sudden, I wept. Because I saw that I was that hypocrite. I was pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. In fact, I tried to cover myself in my spiritual nakedness with my athletic abilities. I was a captain of my tennis team in my high school. I was the enforcer on my hockey team. You know, some of you know who play hockey, that every hockey team has an enforcer. Yes, even in high school. And the enforcer job is not usually the best player, he's actually the toughest player, who goes after the best player on the other team, who intimidates other players, who does the dirty checks, who gets into fights. That was me before I found Christ. I also tried to cover my shameful nakedness with my academic abilities. I said, I'm going to prove myself. I want to get the highest SAT scores. I want to go to a top college. And even though I went to the University of Pennsylvania, it does not define me. Brothers and sisters, do not try to cover your shameful nakedness with the fig leaves of your education. Do not try to cover your shameful nakedness with your golf handicap. I said it, brothers. I was with you last month when some of you were like, man, I shot an 89. I could have shot an 85, but this and that, this and that. Listen, brothers, some of you, your golf handicap is your life handicap. It is. Your golf handicap is your life. Because if you get down to single digits, if you become a 9, you made it. You've broken 80 consistently. But so what? You know, Sean's still going to beat you. Matthew's still going to beat you. That's okay. Jung's still going to beat you. That's all right. Because your righteousness is not found in your golf handicap. Your righteousness is not in the car you drive. The righteousness is not in the university you attend. Your righteousness is not in how many letters follow your last name. Your righteousness is in Christ. Allow his robes of righteousness to cover your nakedness. And you will be whole. You will be filled. You will be at peace. And when you meet people from Harvard, you won't be intimidated. That's right. When you meet people from Yale, you will not be intimidated because you know that that's just wrapping paper. It's the gift inside that's really important. Do you see that? When you come across a very beautiful person, do you feel insecure? When you come across a multimillionaire, do you feel insecure? It's because you're focusing on the wrapping paper. Jesus wants you to see the gift inside. And I find that most attractive people, most very wealthy people, are insecure just like everybody else. Whether you're a high school student, whether you're a grad student, whether you're a lawyer, whether you're a janitor, whether you're a teacher, whether you're an electrician, we all suffer from the spiritual handicap of being pitiful, poor, blind, naked, without Jesus. And he says, come, buy from me gold that lasts forever. Come, put on my robes of righteousness. And come, put salt on your eyes so that you could see. Listen, brothers and sisters, can you see this truth in your life? Can you see that you are nothing without Jesus? That he is the vine. We are his branches. And when we remain in him and rooted in him, we will bear much fruit. But apart from Jesus, we can do nothing. He tells us, verse 19, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. Some of you might be offended right now. Some of you are going to come to Q&A and say, Pastor, I'm offended. I want you to come. Let's talk about it. Let's process it. Because the gospel is offensive. It tells us that we cannot do it on our own. Before the gospel is good news, it is bad news. And the bad news is the reality of our spiritual sickness and our spiritual death. That we try to cover our shameful nakedness with fig leaves that do not last. But he has given us eternal clothes to wear. Those whom I love are rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Be fervent and repent. Brothers and sisters, when was the last time you repented? Honestly, for some of you, it was last year's retreat. You know, we like to repent at retreats. Like, Lord, I'm so sorry. I lived my life for you. But then what happens the other 51 weeks of the year? Come on. We can't be once a year Christians. We cannot be retreat Christians. We cannot be Sunday Christians. We need to be Christians who are in love with Jesus, our Savior. And when we are in love with Jesus, we'll repent, not only to God, but we'll repent to the people that we hurt. And those husbands in this room, you need to repent to your wives. You put yourself and your desires and your wants ahead of your spouse. And moms, some of you know where you need to repent. Some of you are tiger moms. Some of you love your children more than your husband. Maybe you need to repent to your husband for that. If you put your children ahead of your husband, you're living an upside-down value of God's kingdom. Your marriage is the foundation of your family, those of you who are married. And if you do not honor and love your spouse, you do not honor and love God, and you do not honor and love your children. God wants you to live lives that are full of humility and repentance. And for those of you who are in school, ask God to show you where you have been that duplicitous friend to the people at school, where you have smiled in front of your friends, but then you talked behind their back. I want you to ask Jesus, Lord, what do you want me to do? Maybe he wants you to go and apologize to that person, how you've wronged them. You cannot be a Sunday Christian. Either you're a Christian all the time, or you're not a Christian. There's no lukewarm Christianity. He will spit you out of his mouth. That's why he says in verse 20, and that's why verse 20 is so important. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. Brothers and sisters, Jesus is here right now. And he's knocking on the door of your heart right now. The question is, will you let him in or will you keep him out? You know, it's uncomfortable to let Jesus that close, to be honest. Because when Jesus is that close, he'll tell you, don't spend the extra $300 on that new driver. You want to give that money to the missions team. Lord, I want that new driver. I need that new driver. The missions team needs it more, right? God knows what we need. And when you listen to God, he'll give you guidance. He'll give you leading. But if you do not listen to God, you will be wandering in this wilderness of life for many, many years. Listen, I know Riverside Community Church is considering many different options about the future of RCC. Are you listening to God? Or are you listening to conventional wisdom? Are you listening to what makes business sense or what makes sense in the kingdom of God? The economy of heaven is not the economy of mankind. Where are you investing in? Are you seeking the Lord? Brothers and sisters, I want to encourage you. We have 2 weeks before the retreat, right? Pastor Will is a very good friend of mine. And he and I were talking very deeply at a conference a couple months ago about God's Spirit. It was called the Holy Spirit Weekend. I know he's preaching on the Holy Spirit at your retreat. I want you to encourage for the next 3 weeks to consider fasting at least one day each week. That might be fasting from social media. Yes. Fasting from social media is maybe necessary for some of you. For some of you, you might be fasting from food. And some of you are foodies, like, Lord, I don't know if I could do that. I want you to quote Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I want you to consider, and I'm not telling you what to do. I'm just saying, Lord, what do you want me to do, Lord? Pray and ask God, what do you want me to give up for one day each week for the next 3 weeks so that I could listen to what you want me to say, that my heart would be broken for you, that I would hunger and thirst for you more than I hunger and thirst for the things of this world. And when you do, your life will be transformed. Your life will begin to change to actually look more like Jesus. Riverside Community Church is a church that wants to become like Jesus. The purpose of this church is not to have nice programs. The purpose of the church is not to have multiple missions trips, even though they have it. And even though you do outreach to Elmwood Park and Bergen County, the purpose of this church is to glorify the name of Jesus by becoming like Jesus yourself. And when you become like Jesus, you will love people. You will give up a week's vacation to bless people, to serve people, to take people into your homes that need a place to stay, for you to lend your car, even your sports car, to people who do not have transportation. If you've never lent your car to someone else, you're holding on to your car too tightly. You need to share God's blessings with those in need. God blesses you so that you could bless one another. When you do that, when you trust God enough to do that, you will experience deeper fellowship with Jesus. I remember the first time, many years ago, a deacon in my church had a car accident and needed a car. He said, oh, Pastor Jim, could I borrow your car? It was the first car I ever bought brand new. I had it for like a year. And of course, I knew what to do, but like I was like pump fake my hand and my keys. But I knew I had to reach into my pocket and, here, Shorey, please take the car when you're done with whatever you would need to. Feel free to use it because it's the Lord's car. I said that, but my heart was still aching. But he brought it back without a scratch, but it was something that was helpful for me to go through. And by going on this mission trip, you realize that it's not about you. It's about the Lord. And when you have the Lord first, you will experience great joy. You know, joy is spelled J-O-Y. And many people in the church do not have much joy in their life because they're not living with J-O-Y. J-O-Y stands for Jesus first, others second, and yourself third. If you put Jesus first, say, Lord, I'll go wherever you want me to go. I'll do whatever you want me to do. I'll give up. I'll lend whatever you want me to lend. Put Jesus first by putting others second and taking care of their needs before yourself. You will experience God's joy, the joy of salvation, the joy of transformed lives. And that's what God is calling us to do. Let me close at verse 21 and 22. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down from my father's, with my father on his throne. Whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. God is saying to us, live a life that honors him. Live a life that reflects Jesus. And I know that the 8 students that are going to Mexico on this mission trip, you're going to live differently those 8 days in Mexico. You know that every day that you're there, you're living for Jesus first, others second, and yourself third. I believe that you will experience greater joy when you're there than you have when you play Valorant on the computer. You have greater joy than even winning your regional county football game or basketball game. Joy that lasts comes from Jesus. And when you live with your life in mission, you will live with his purpose in mind. And his love, his joy, and his peace will fill you. Listen, these young men are going for 8 days, and they'll live a very focused life because they're on mission. But do you realize, RCC, that for the next 80 years, you're on a mission too? Right now, you are on God's mission. And his mission is the Great Commission. Go into all the world and make disciples of every nation. We in Bergen County have the privilege of living with people from every country in the world. Are you reaching out? Are you loving? Are you praying? Are you sacrificing as if you're in Tijuana, Mexico? Because you are on God's mission. But if you can imagine one of the guys, let's say one of the guys says, you know what, I don't want to help the other people. I don't want to do VBS. It's like, I'm going to the beach. I'm going to go surfing. I'm going to do what I want to do. It's like, what are you doing? We're here for them, right? But so many of us are saying, God, I need a break. God, I'm going to do what I want to do. Do not be a lukewarm Christian, because there is no such thing. Say, Lord, if you are a little distant from God today, repent and draw near. Turn away from your selfishness. Turn away from your fig leaves and turn to the Lord, that he may come and fill you with his love, with his joy, with his peace. Would you pray with me? Pastor Sam, would you come? Let's spend a few moments this morning to come into God's presence and say, Lord, speak, for your servant is listening. We do not want to be Sunday Christians. We do not want to be once a week Christians who repent on the retreat but live selfishly the next 51 weeks of the year. But we want to fast, we want to pray, we want to seek, we want to see, we want to know, we want to experience the full manifest presence of God. Lord Jesus, come now. Speak to us through your Spirit that we may hear and obey. We pray not only for the 8 people going on this missions trip, but we pray for all of us here that we would see that we're all on a mission right now, to no longer live for ourselves, but to live for him who was crucified, raised again for us. That we no longer live, but we live by faith in the Son of God who rose us from our sinful and selfish and pitiful lives. We want to live for you wholeheartedly because you are worthy, Lord. Would you spend a few moments now just seeking him in prayer, asking God to show you where you have been selfish, where you need to repent, where you need him more in your life. Let's pray.
second verse one more time. Make it your prayer.
Of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May the peace and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you and fill you and motivate you to become like Jesus all your days. Amen and amen. Please turn and greet one another, and if you'd like to stay for Q&A, please feel free to come forward. Thank you.